Today's date is March the 17th, 1997. My name is Linda Davidson, L-I-N-D-A-D-A-V-I-D-S-O-N. I'm interviewing the survivor, Dr. Hanna Strawczynski, née Richter, H-A-N-N-A, last name, S-T-R-A-W-C-Z-Y-N-S-K-I, maiden name, R-Y-C-H-T-E-R. The interview is being conducted in English and taking place in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Today's date is March the 17th, 1997. My name is Linda Davidson, L-I-N-D-A-D-A-V-I-D-S-O-N. I'm interviewing the survivor, Dr. Hanna Strawczynski, born Richter, H-A-N-N-A, last name, S-T-R-A-W-C-Z-Y-N-S-K-I, maiden name, R-Y-C-H-T-E-R. The interview is being conducted in English and taking place in Montreal, Quebec, Canada. Please introduce yourself, your full name.
I am Hanna Strawczynski. My maiden name is Richter. I was born in Poland, Częstochowa, which is a city in the southwestern part of Poland.
And what is your date of birth?
I was born on the 17th of October, 1927.
Does everybody call you Hanna?
No, it is not usual actually in Poland to be called by a full official name. My name is Hanka, H-A-N-K-A, and this is the way I am known to my friends and my family. I didn't use it much here in Canada. Here I'm Hanna, but it is not the Hanna with an H at the end, it's a different name. It's close to Anna or Anne. It's the same name, basically.
And if you were living in Poland, your last name, Strawczynski, would that be a little different as well?
Yes, it would be a little different. It would be Strawczynska. And actually, this is what it is. The ski at the end signifies a male. And it is A at the end for females. However, here for legal reasons, we were told that it's better to have the same exact spelling.
In Częstochowa, can you tell us your pre-war address?
Yes. I lived on Aleja Wolności, which means the Boulevard of Freedom. A very nice street, number 19. I remember it well, and I saw it after the war several times.
Could you spell that for us, the name of the street?
Aleja, A-L-E-J-A, Wolności, W-O-L-N-O-S-C-I.
And can you spell for us Częstochowa as well, please?
Certainly. C-Z-E-S-T-O-C-H-O-W-A.
Thanks. We'd like to start off learning about your family. If you could tell us about your mom, her name, where she was born, and what kind of family, how long they'd lived in the area, please.
Yes. Both my mother and my father were born in Częstochowa. They were both born in 1987. My mother in February and my father in June 1987.
Sorry, what year?
June.
What year were they born?
1897. Did I make a mistake?
Yeah. That's okay.
1897. My father's family was a fairly large, traditional Jewish family, Orthodox. I remember my mother wearing a wig, a shaitel. I didn't know my grandfather. He, on my father's side, he died before I was born. My grandfather worked in a sawmill. He was a worker. This was a very poor family.
What was his name?
His name was Leib. And they had six sons. My father was, I believe, the second oldest. My father's name was David.
Did he have a nickname that people used?
Well, Davidek, maybe it is sort of a diminutive. He was loved by people. He had a very sunny disposition and he was a very kind man, so everybody liked him very much. And he was not very tall. He was rather on the small side, so they used to call him Davidek. My father, as a child, went to a heder, and then for a few years he was in yeshiva. But I was told, you know, like family tales, my mother used to tell me a lot about it, that he was not a very good student there. Instead of being a very good student, he drew pictures. So he didn't last long there. He was a very talented man. He drew, he painted, and he was a writer, but I'll talk about it maybe a little bit later. As a very young boy, at the age of 15, my father started to work also in a factory in Częstochowa. And this is, I think, where he was exposed to the working class, both Jewish and Polish, and where he started to be involved and interested in the plight of the poor. He, at the age of 18, became a member of the SDKPL, SDKPL, which was the Social Democracy of the Kingdom of Poland and Lithuania. It was the party of Rosa Luxemburg and the precursor of the Polish Communist Party.
How did his family respond to this affiliation? How did his family, his parents?
Well, this is a very interesting question. How did this family of traditional Jewish people respond to this affiliation? I only know that he was always a member of the family. They loved him, they protected him. They took my mother in, who also had similar political views. So they must have been very tolerant people and very loving people. He was not the only one to be a communist in this family, because the oldest son, who emigrated to Uruguay before the war, and I never knew him, was also a communist.
What was his name?
His name was Moritz.
And what occupation did your father pursue?
Well, my father became very involved in the work of the of his party. He became a union organizer and a publicist, and he was writing for different left-wing, of course, papers, both Yiddish and Polish. He did all types of things during his life, but this was the main thing. The Communist Party was illegal in Poland. So he was not a legal person. Therefore, he did not live long in with his family in Częstochowa, because this being a rather small town, the police knew him very well, and he did get arrested many times, and he also served prison terms several times. So finally, this became an illegal existence, and he lived in Warsaw. There were many communists in this generation, many Jewish communists. They were doubly persecuted, I think. They felt it very strongly, doubly, as Jews, the persistent anti-Semitism, the racial thing, and also the poverty. And this is why the Polish Communist Party had a large number of Jews. It doesn't mean that all Jews were communists. This was a minority, I'm sure. But the party itself had a lot of Jewish communists.
We'd like to hear about your mum, her name, yes, and what kind of person she was.
My mother's story was even more unusual, maybe, than my father's story.
Her name?
My mother
first?
Came, her name was Felicia Fela.
And maiden name?
Klin. She was born to a very poor family of 10 children, family of 12. She started working as a young girl. She didn't have much education. She had maybe 3-4 years of school, and started working at a young age in a factory of dolls. It was celluloid dolls. She, at work, met a young man, not a Jew, a young Christian Paul, and it was a great love. But of course, there was no way for her family to accept a Paul. So, around the age of, I believe she must have been 18 or 19, just before the end of the First World War, she left her family and she lived with this young man. The family said Shiva, as if she died. And I never knew my mother's family. She never had any contact with them anymore. At the very end of the First World War in 1918, the young man was in the street and he was killed by a stray bullet. Of course, I never knew this story before the war. I mean, when my mother was alive. I only learned it after the war when I met a former friend and a neighbor of my mother's family. And she, Mrs. Lewartowska. Mrs. Lewartowska knew a lot about my mother, and she told me this story.
Did you have any siblings, brother and sister?
Yes. I had a brother who was 4.5 years older than I was. His name was Henrik Henik. He was born in 1924. So the three of us, I mean, as far as I can remember, my father did not live with us.
Where did he live?
He was in Warsaw, and we would join him as a family only during school vacations. So every summer vacation, all three of us would go to Warsaw, and sometimes when there was money, they would rent a little place in the country close to Warsaw, and this is when we were together. Occasionally we would go to see my father also during spring break or this type of things.
What was the effect on the family of your father living so far away, and financially and otherwise?
Well, financially the situation was very bad. We never had money. My father's earning from his writing, from his other work, were very scanty and very irregular. My mother was an incredibly brave and energetic woman. And the burden of running the family, keeping us clothed and fed, and bringing us up was on her shoulder. She did all types of things. She, before she had children, she was working in a hospital. I don't know exactly in what capacity, probably help to a nurse. So she learned how to make injections and other little medical tasks. She would do it privately. Later on, she learned how to do a manicure, and she would have her clients coming to our room. I say room because we lived in one room. It was a large room, a front room of a nice building in a nice part of the city. However, this room did not have water and did not have a bathroom. We had nice furniture, a little, not very much, but the furniture was designed by my father and made to order. So I remember this wardrobe that was a combination of bookshelves and wardrobe. Now it is more common to see this type of things, but then it was a novelty. And there was a day bed, and I, with my mother, slept in the day bed. And then on the other side of the window, there was a little sofa, and this is where my brother slept. There was also a small desk where we did our homework, and a table where we ate. And in addition, there was this very narrow table where my mother worked on her manicure, between the two beds, just under the window. In the back of the room, there was a stove, a coal stove, and a pail of clean water and a pail of dirty water behind a curtain. It was very, very clean, and nobody coming in would ever imagine that behind the curtain there is, you know, this type of thing. To the bathroom, we had to go to the second courtyard, and I was very much afraid to go there as a child and never went alone. During the night, of course, if necessary, we used the chamber pot. I remember close to this latrine in the second courtyard, there lived a family, very large. There must have been 14 children, family of a Jewish cobbler, incredibly poor.
Remember their names?
No, I don't remember their name. Or maybe I do. Hasklevich? I'm not sure. And I always was able to appreciate that comparing to them, we were very rich. We were always very nicely dressed and fed properly, but my mother was performing some miracles.
What were your happiest memories from your childhood?
My happiest memories. Well, my happiest memories were, of course, being together with my father, a summer vacation. Yeah. These were very, very happy times. There were always people, friends of my parents coming in. There were these great political discussions that I was listening to, some fights between the Bund and the communists and the Zionists. And we were always fascinated by that. My mother took also a very vivid part in all this. She didn't have much education, but she was a very intelligent woman. She loved music, so did my father. And we always, always were exposed to classical music, to opera music.
What language did you speak among yourselves?
Polish. Yeah. However, my parents did speak Yiddish occasionally among themselves, and my father was he was a real polyglot, and every language he spoke was absolutely beautiful. He was a Yiddishist, and I don't know how to translate it into English. But it means that she really loved Jewish culture, the Yiddish language, and he wrote a lot in Yiddish. He also wrote in Polish, and in his Polish writings, I remember the verses, the poems that he would send us. And some of them were sent. He once had a long term in jail. I was only 3 then, and we were receiving from jail these beautiful little poems in Polish for children, and I still remember them.
Could you tell us one from memory?
Oh, yes, I could. It will take maybe 2 minutes.
Please.
This was, my mother sent him a picture of the 2 children. Just holding hands together. And he sent back this beautiful piece of paper with a drawing of this picture. Only on this drawing we wore masks. And the little poem was called Kto jesteście? Means who are you? And it goes like that. Jeśli wola, jeśli łaska, niechże powie któraś maska. Tajemnicę niech mi zdradzi. Któż to kogo tu prowadzi? Kto jesteście? Cóż za jedni? Czy bogaci, czy też biedni? Czy wy młodzi, czy starzyzna? Wszystko niechże szczerze przyzna i powiedzieć niech też raczy, co to wszystko, co to znaczy. Tajemnicze te opaski, te dziwaczne czarne maski? Czy zabawa to parada, czy też może Alibaba? Albo inny jakiś groźny, jakiś straszny herszt przemożny tu pod maską się ukrywa, przecież często różnie bywa. Albo może wyspiskowcy, niebezpieczni wywrotowcy starych ładów, niszczyciele? Z pionierami gdzieś na czele, na calutkim, wielkim świecie nowe życie budujecie? Choć sekretne są to sprawy, mówić proszę bez obawy. Śmiało przyznać się możecie, pozostanie to w sekrecie. Wierzcie, mili, wierzcie bowiem, że nikomu nic nie powiem. Więc maseczki, mówcież wreszcie. Któż wy tacy, kto jesteście? This is the verse, and basically what it means is he speculates who we could be, who we are. Are we rich, or are we poor? Are we maybe some terrible bandits like Alibaba and others? Or maybe we are little rebels who would like to build a new good life all over the world. And he promises that he will never tell anybody, so please tell. My husband used a very sophisticated language in every language that he spoke.
I don't obviously understand the words, but anyone could hear the rhythm and the music and the rhyming.
Oh, yeah, there is
throughout.
A rhyming, yeah.
It's very discernible, yeah. Thank you. What I wanted to ask you, what kind of schooling you had in Częstochowa?
In Częstochowa, we first went, both my brother and I, to a Polish government school, how do you say it? However, when I was in grade two, there was a search in our house, a night search. They were looking for illegal literature. They were maybe looking for my father. I don't remember. And after that, we were told that we cannot attend these public schools.
So you think it's as a result of his communist
sympathies? Yes, it was a result of the communism, yeah. So finally, my mother sent us to a private school that was an expensive school, but she paid very little or she didn't pay at all. And this was called the Jewish Gymnasium. It was a very good school in Częstochowa. It was a Polish language school. All the instructions were in Polish, except for the Bible and Hebrew. So for 3 years I stayed in this school until the war, in grade three, four, grade. No, maybe I was in grade three when, yeah, so it was four, five, and six I spent in the school.
And you mentioned that it was a good school. What are the activities that you remember in particular from the gymnasium?
Oh, I remember little ballet classes where we danced classical ballet. I enjoyed it very much. There was a wonderful choir. There was a wonderful orchestra. My brother was playing the trumpet and he was very, very musical. He also whistled beautifully. And I remember school performances, very, very exciting, all types of very interesting things. It was a happy school. Yeah.
At that stage, did you lose contact with your non-Jewish friends from the public school?
No. No, I didn't.
You mixed it quite freely.
I was too young then. We just made a transition. I don't remember anybody from grade one and grade two. No.
Zinski, nay Richter. Hanna, we were talking about, I wanted to ask you about Częstochowa. It is such a special Polish city, and I'd like you to give us a little bit of background.
Yes, Częstochowa's greatest claim to fame is the cloister of Jasna Góra. Jasna Góra meaning Luminous Mountain, something like that. It's a very old cloister dating, I believe, from 13th or 14th century. And they have a very famous icon there, the Virgin Mary with the child. It's an interesting icon because the Virgin Mary is black in this icon, and it's called the Czarna Panienka, or Black Madonna. It's a very rich icon too. It's studded with gems. I had a babysitter, sort of my mother's helper, who would come 2-3 times a week to help my mother in housework.
What was her name?
Her name was Hella. Hella was young when I remember her, and Hella would sometimes take care of me and go out with me, and she would take me to Jasna Góra, to the cloister, so I saw the famous icon. It was very, very common for Polish nannies to take Jewish children to churches. They didn't mean to convert us in any way, just... I loved Hella. She was an interesting person. She was a very simple girl. And she was very attached to us. This, of course, did not disturb her occasionally to take part in some anti-Semitic little demonstrations. At least, you know, our neighbors told us a few times that they saw her together with her boyfriend, who was unfortunately an alcoholic, and he ruined her. However, Hella was truly attached to us. And after the war, Hella found me. I was then in Częstochowa. And she would drop in into this room that I shared with a few other girls. She would pick up my dirty clothes and wash it. She did it many times. When I didn't meet her during that time. I didn't pay her for it. I was busy. I was at school. And this was at that time she was a ruined woman, and she probably died very, very soon. Alcohol, poverty, beating.
You mentioned that she and her boyfriend took part in anti-Semitic demonstrations.
Yeah.
Tell us a little bit about that in pre-war Częstochowa.
Yes, sure. Well, this was 1930s that I'm talking about, and the wave of anti-Semitism was growing in the 1930s.
You think it was a result of the rise of Hitler?
Some of it was the result of the rise of Hitler. It was already after Piłsudski died, and Piłsudski was the marshal, the creator of the Polish legions, who was a socialist in his youth, actually. And actually, he apparently was believed in a multinational Poland, the Ukrainians. There were many, many minorities in Poland. But the government became more and more rightist. Goering was hunting in our great forests with some of his friends from the Polish government. And there was, I remember particularly this one organization, ONR, which meant the Camp of National something or other, I don't remember. They had a local just on the opposite side of our street, and they had a little newspaper that was called ABC, but it sounded abece in Poland. And always before this particular local, I remember there was this man who was lame, and I was afraid of him. He was selling this paper, and he was saying this little, while selling the paper, repeating this little ditto, ABC walczy, ABC czuwa, ABC Żydów z Polski usuwa, which means the ABC is fighting, the ABC is vigilant, the ABC removes Jews from Poland. And so I remember this ever since, you know, I think about the street, I see this little man. Of course, yeah, there were incidents of not really pogroms, but some breaking of the windows by hooligans. More and more of it as the 1939 approached.
We'll get to 1939 a little later. Could you tell us about the Jewish community in Częstochowa, the size, the institutions,
yes,
the schools?
Well, I don't know very much, but I know that it was a fairly large and thriving Jewish community. About one-third of the population in Częstochowa had 120,000 people before the war. Now it's double the number. And
so you're saying one-third of that were Jews?
One-third, about 30,000 were Jews, that's right. Jews from every possible class, and there were people in trade. A lot of Częstochowa was an industrial city. Even before the war, there was a steel mill, there were some trade schools. So trade, crafts.
A Jewish trade school, would you say?
There was a Jewish trade school, yeah. There was a Jewish trade school, yeah. And of course, many workers and many poor people and some Hasids and, you know, the usual makeup of a Jewish community, but certainly it wasn't the shtetl type of a population. It was much more advanced, and certainly socialistic ideas were very developed among Jewish people in Transylvania.
How about Zionism as a movement? Zionism?
Oh, yes, yes. I know a little about it because we didn't have any connection with Zionism. But all parties strived. There were the right Zionists, the right to the left, Hashomer Hatzair and others. There was a very strong Bund group, Jewish socialists, that wanted to build their socialism and their Jewish life in Poland as opposed to Palestine.
Would you say that your parents mixed in a mixed milieu, or were they
yes,
many Jews?
Yes, very, very much so, yeah. Mixed, you mean from the point of view of Jewish, non-Jewish? Yes, yes, but the majority were, most of them were Jewish.
Mixed, more intellectuals, though, sort of?
Yes, mixed politically also. We were many friends from Bund. We had many friends from Bund, and yeah, the generation of my parents was absolutely fascinating. I think about them often. They were just out of the ghettos. This generation, they broke out of the ghetto. They broke with the very religious and very traditional part of the society. And they were very often self-educated, but amazingly educated. My father was an example, but I met some other people like that. They were people who were dreaming, had a dream. Like King had a dream, they had a dream too, of equality, of justice. And racial equality, of course, a world with no anti-Semitism. And this is what brought many of them to the Communist Party. It's terribly sad that most of them, if they did not perish during the war, murdered by Hitler, they perished in Soviet camps, murdered by Stalin.
This
God that failed. Yeah. But they were true idealists. It's hard to find people like that now.
I can see that you grew up with a very stimulating atmosphere.
Yes.
You did mention to me that you wanted to tell us about one of your neighbors, Hirsch Freiman.
Yes.
Before we talk, you know, end off with the pre-war period.
Yes. Well, maybe I'll mention him when I talk about the beginning of the war.
We can go to that now.
Yeah.
In 1939, how things deteriorated.
Yes. Well, 1939, of course, was a very tense, the end of 1939, like September, the end of the summer. There was a lot of talk about the war. We, of course, you know, listened to what was going on in Germany.
You had a radio at home?
I think we did. Yeah, we did have a radio at home because we listened to music on the radio, too. Yeah. And I remember very clearly the few days before the outbreak of the war, and then this Friday of September 1939, this was the 1st of September 1939, Friday. What was happening was that my brother, who was then in the last few grades of high school, had as a subject at school military training. This was a compulsory subject in high school for boys. So they had little uniforms and they were taught target shooting, they had rifles, this type of things. And at the beginning of the war, on the 1st, they were called in to school as a group. And we, the two of us, were left at home. My father was in Warsaw, of course. The panic was incredible. People were terribly afraid of gas. Poison gas, they remembered it from the First World War. They were afraid of bombs. And my brave mother, who was always so cool and brave, lost her head completely. There was a group of neighbors, a large group of neighbors, going to escape, running. And she joined them with me, leaving Hennig, my brother, there. We started to run, so we went on the road. The road was, this was the first horror that I saw. This was a real mayhem, what was going on the road. There were thousands and thousands of people going all directions. People from cities were escaping to the country. People from the country were escaping to the cities. There were some military units. There were wagons, horses, and there were German planes. And these small planes, I believe they were called Stukas, they would dive down so we could see, actually, you know, the pilot. And they would machine gun people, civilian population, and I remember many attacks like this, lying in the fields, and I don't know how we survived this. This is the first sight of death and dying that I had in my life, a lot of wounded, dying, and dead people and horses lying around. Anyhow, this didn't last long because our invaders caught up with us very quickly. And we returned to Częstochowa after 4 or 5 days. my mother was going crazy about what happened to Henik, but we found him safe at home. They never took any part in any fight. Częstochowa did not fight. So we came back, and we came back to hear what happened in Częstochowa on Sunday, which means on the third day of the war. We were still on the road on this, no, it was Monday. They came in on Sunday, the Germans, and on Monday they rounded up hundreds and hundreds of people, Jews and Poles. At that moment they didn't make any difference. They marched them through the city, beating them and hitting them and ridiculing them, and they machine gun a lot of them. I only heard it. I didn't see any of that, but this day was called the Bloody Monday in Częstochowa. So this was the beginning of the war.
What was the immediate effect on your family and the Jewish community of the German occupation?
Well, the Jews, right from the beginning, started to be a prey. The Germans, particularly Jews in traditional garb, Jews with beards, right away they started to cut the beards, to ask these Jews to jump in the streets like dogs, like rabbits, like groups of soldiers just looking at it and laughing their heads off and making pictures. This started right away. But of course nobody could ever imagine what's going to happen. I mean, our imagination did not go that far. So Jews like Jews, you know, Jews were used to different times, and well, we'll survive this too. We have to be careful, we have to, you know. Well, anyhow, I didn't stay long in Częstochowa.
Were there restrictions that came into effect?
Oh yeah, right away there were restrictions. There was a curfew, and there was, I don't believe that the armbands in Częstochowa came that early, no. Oh, we had to give up our radios, money, of course, gems, all types of constant ransom type of situation. And the Judenrat was formed in Częstochowa quite early, but I don't remember this really.
But you were going to leave. You left with your mother.
My mother, my brother and myself left Częstochowa because we got news finally. I mean, after it calmed down a little bit, we got news from my father that he is going to the Russian side. You remember that on the 17th of September 1939, the Russians came in and Poland was divided. They took the part of the eastern part of Poland, and there was a border now between the Russians and the Germans, and these two were allies after the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact. So my father escaped to the Russian side, and he told us in his message to come to Warsaw, and from Warsaw he will smuggle us to be with him. So my mother packed up whatever we had. She sold these few pieces of furniture that we had, closed the place. We spent the last few days with this neighbor that I mentioned before, Mr. Freiman and his family, This was a wonderful family. He was a tinsmith. There was always a faint smell of tar around him because he worked on the roofs very often. And we were very, very friendly. I'll talk about him later on, about what happened to him in the ghetto, the small ghetto. We spent the few last days in Częstochowa with this family, and we went by train to Warsaw.
Was it risky for you to travel?
Well, no, it was just at that time as risky as for you. Well, it was very crowded, and of course there were roundups constantly. They were catching people, both Poles, Jews, whoever, for hard labor, for dirty labor to send to Germany. You have to be careful, but the train started to go and they were very, very crowded, but we did get on the train.
How far was Częstochowa from Warsaw, would you say?
I'm afraid I can't tell you in the number of kilometers, but it was quite a few hours on train. And now, in Warsaw, we came to Warsaw in the late afternoon, but still before the curfew. And we knew Warsaw from before the war. It was a nice, very lively city, a big city. It looked awful. There were ruins. Warsaw was fighting. Warsaw was 3 weeks, I believe, was a siege of Warsaw, and it was bombed heavily. So we saw the ruins, rubble on the street. It was late October, I believe, or maybe early November, because there was snow already and it was very, very cold. And we went into the Jewish quarter, I mean the traditional Jewish quarter.
What streets would those have been, would you remember?
Yes, I'll be talking about this street maybe later on. But what we were going to do was we were going to stay with a woman and a child in the same situation that we were. They were friends of my father. Her husband was also there, and she was also supposed to. So it was a communal apartment with four rooms, and each family lived in a different room. With a common kitchen, and we were going to live with this woman. The moment we came into this Jewish quarter, it was not yet the official ghetto, but this is where the ghetto later on happened. I was quite frightened. Parts of it were already barbed wired, and there were these big signs, signboards, no, billboards, epidemics of typhus, beware, keep away, this type of things. It was very dirty, very empty in the streets, many windows taped and covered with paper. And, you know, it was quite frightening. We stayed in this apartment, and within 2 weeks, my brother took off. My father sent some people to smuggle him through the border. The border at that time was sometimes open, sometimes closed, but it was becoming closed. And he joined my father in Białystok. I'll talk about what happened to them later. Soon afterwards, the border was closed between the Russian part and the German part of Poland. people were still going, but it was not very safe. And at that point, my father decided that he will get us a visa to come in officially, not to be submitted to the danger of crossing this illegal border. This, of course, was a tragic mistake, and this is how we were stuck with my mother in the Warsaw ghetto. You asked me about the street. We lived on Dzielna Street, Dzielna 17. Dzielna means brave, and you had to be brave to live there. We lived on the fourth floor, front room. We were facing a big and famous Warsaw prison, the Pawiak. From our window, we could see the Pawiak, the courtyard. We could see the sentry boxes and the guards walking around. But they could see us too, and they watched for us, and if they saw anybody in the window, they would shoot. And sometimes they were just shooting to amuse themselves. So our windows were permanently covered with black paper. And I was sternly, sternly admonished by my mother not to go close to the window.
So there was a lot of fear.
Oh, there was a lot of fear, yeah. I was 12 then. I turned 12 in October. So I was really very young, and there's a lot of things I don't remember. But since I was young, my mother still sheltered me as much as she could. So there's a lot of things I was not at the beginning exposed to. We didn't have money. To go and get some learning, to join some illegal teaching courses, classes, we didn't have the money. We didn't really know a lot of people in Warsaw. We were together with this lady. And there was very little I could do. Going out was not safe. I'm talking about the first few months, so it's very, very early. The ghetto was not officially there not yet, and we were wearing armbands.
Richter, we were talking about your arrival in Warsaw just before the ghetto was established, if we could continue in the same line.
Well, the ghetto was not yet officially established, but we were told to wear armbands with the Star of David.
Did you have to register with any organization that you were resident in Warsaw?
I'm sure, yeah. In Poland, always there was this when you lived in a house, you had to be registered there as living there. Yeah, but I don't remember these details.
Your mother may have attended to that.
Yes. So I mentioned to you that there was no money, and food became a problem very, very soon. There was no money to attend classes for me. I was 12. Going out was not very safe. At the beginning, during the first few months, there were some little groups of Polish hooligans. Very often they were actually organized or partially organized by the Germans, who would roam the streets and beat up Jews. I remember once I left home to go somewhere, and we lived fairly close to Ogród Krasińskich, which is a little garden, a little park of Krasiński was a famous Polish poet. And this was not part of the ghetto, but of the Jewish quarter, but it was just adjacent to the Jewish quarter. So I remember to cut through this, I decided to cut through this park, and I noticed there a group, a large group of people watching. And I had the presence of mind to pull off my armband, and I approached it. And I saw a person bloodied, you know, being beaten. And I saw a German making a picture of it. So what they did was they would then say, well, this is what's happening. The Poles are beating up the Jews, so we have to really protect the Jews in the ghetto. We have to create a ghetto. This is all types of small tactics that they used this way. So going out was not very safe. The ghetto was swelling. The ghetto population was swelling. It was the deportation from little towns and villages around the ghetto. The Jews were being deported from there, and they all flocked into the Warsaw ghetto. These people were the first victim of typhus and hunger. They may have been quite well-to-do in their towns, but everything was taken from them. Many of them were killed on the way, and when they came, they became beggars. And they became homeless because the Judenrat, the Jewish Judenrat, whatever it's called
in
could not, even though they, I believe, they tried to place these people somewhere, but it was very hard. In addition, the ghetto was starting already, and Jews who lived all over Poland, all over Warsaw, were also moving into the ghetto. Some Poles moving out. So, as I said, there were homeless people. And as the time went on, the 1940, the middle of 1940, the sights of these people was absolutely terrible. There were children, there were starving children, little skeletons with swollen bellies, begging in the street. You could see entire families, and you could see a family that started as a large family, maybe six, and then the children were dying off, or occasionally you could see just a child or a couple of children left, and the bodies, the corpses of their parents lying in the streets. There are many corpses lying in the street, sometimes covered by a newspaper.
Who was responsible for collecting the corpses?
Yeah, well, the Judenrat was responsible. There was a collection. Every early morning there was a collection. They would just throw these bodies on a wagon.
You witnessed that?
Yes. And they would bury them in a common grave. But what was terribly disturbing to me was the wailing of the children. They even ignored the curfew. We could hear this wailing, this lament constantly in our room up on the fourth floor. This was driving me crazy. I was trying to read. This was the only thing I could do. There were some books in the house. But this was very, very hard.
Were you in contact with your father at all during this period?
Yes, there was a contact.
How?
And there
was
one.
How was the contact made?
Through the mail. There was, but very few somehow, you know, there were some limitations. And there was one, I remember one food package that came, you know, and this was great rejoicing. I remember the Russian sugar, which was a hard ball, a head of sugar, very, very hard, you know. And yeah, but there was very little. I believe they were limited in the amount they could send us. And also there was some limitation in, I don't remember how many letters we got. But we knew that my father is in Białystok. He was an editor of a paper called the Białystoker Stern. It was a Yiddish newspaper. I knew that my brother goes to school and he's going to matriculate there. Well, of course, you know, we always lived with the hope that we will join them. But in the meantime, we had to live somehow. For a while, well, I talked about the children and about the beggars. All that was going on in front of cafes, restaurants, and nightclubs. There was an entire new class of nouveau riche in the ghetto.
Who were they?
Jewish profiteers who took advantage of the shortages, food shortages, who made their dirty business with Germans, with Poles, Polish scam of the Polish society, and they had champagne and dances and balls and food, and I was so young. I don't know what I made out of it. It's very hard, you know, for me to go back and to think what I, as a 13 maybe year old child, looked at. But I know that I was terribly disturbed by the children, by the sight and the sound of these children. And I remember once I was asked to babysit a little girl. Her mother had to go out. This was a friend of my mother or whatever. And I was there alone with the child, and a little skeleton beggar in rags came. They were all over. And there was a piece of bread in the basket. And without any thought or hesitation, I just gave this child this bread. It turned out when this lady came back, the mother of the child, that this was the only food she had for the entire day. And I felt terrible. This is how it was. Well, we had to eat something, and my mother again performed, you know, little miracles trying to feed me. We used to go for a while to the Jewish Writers Union. It was at that time on street that was called Karmelitska. This Karmelitska was a very narrow street and very, very crowded always. Of course, it was crowded with people going after their business. It was crowded with the beggars, and at that time they started snatching whatever you had. If there was a little package in your hands, they would snatch it, looking for food. If it was not food, they would drop it. If it was food, they would devour it immediately. But in addition, the Germans liked to drive through this Karmelitska street, shooting into the crowd. This was a perfect street because there was just there was such a dense crowd. So we were going there to this writers' union because they had a soup kitchen, and it was good food. But after a few months, my mother decided that it's too dangerous to cross the street. So we stopped going there also. Then my mother found a family that would allow me to come once a week for dinner. This was a fairly wealthy family. I hated it. I hated it because they were not nice people to start with. The food was very good. Occasionally I would try to, let's say I got a piece of meat and I tried to save some for my mother and put it in paper napkins, and they would all look at me, and I just refused to go there. Then there was another family that she found. She never stopped. And this was a nicer place. And they had a lot of books.
Do you remember their name? Their family name?
No. No, but I remember the books that I read there. I read, of course, in Polish translation, you know, the entire French classical literature. This was something that I liked to do, and it was a perfect escape. I remember reading Balzac and being completely involved, you know, in this other world.
Took your mind away from your reality.
Yes, yes. What else about the Warsaw Ghetto? Well, of course, you know, the ghetto became closed. The walls were going on all the time. The walls were very tall. There was glass, broken glass, and barbed wires around on above the wall.
Entry and exit from the ghetto was difficult.
There were several entries and exits, and I'll talk about this because I went to one. Yeah. These exits were guarded by Germans, Polish police, and Jewish police. Of course, the Jewish police was already organized, the Judenrat, and Cherniakov, a very famous name, was the head of the Judenrat, and you know that he committed suicide when the action started, when they wanted him to supply the list of people to go first. And he probably tried his best before that, but...
What role did the Judenrat play in the German strategy? Can you tell us?
Oh, they just did everything that the Germans told them to do. This is the way I saw it. They were collecting money, organizing the police, all types of things. And then later on, when Chernyakov killed himself, but he was the only one, and all the others went on providing lists, providing all types of information, trying, I don't know, to save their lives or to save the lives. Maybe they believed, maybe they did. I mean, the ghetto was full of rumors, but it was throughout the war, all types of false rumors. If we do this, they'll stop the action. If we give them this money, or if we give them 10,000 people for a transport, they will not touch the others. The Germans would create this type, and people wanted to believe it, I guess. So some of these things are absolutely ridiculous. You know?
Were there rumors around that you heard of about the extermination camps in Poland?
Well, not yet. When I was, I left the ghetto in 1941, and until then I did not hear. But people were being murdered over there, and they were being sent off, but the talk was about labor camps.
Why did you and your mother leave the ghetto? And when was that?
Okay. So as the time went on, our hopes for this visa to join my father was dwindling. And then it died, of course, completely when the Germans attacked Russia on the 22nd of June 1941. At that point, we lived alone already in this room, because the other woman with her child went to live with her family. She wanted to be close to her family. She was from Warsaw. We lived alone, and we started to be blackmailed by Polish police. There was this policeman who came and who told us that he knows everything, of course, about our correspondence and connections with Russia and communism and whatnot, and he will give us up if we don't pay. Well, we didn't have anything. We didn't have anything. So he came a few more times, and somehow he probably came to the conclusion that we really don't have anything. And he was maybe decent enough, you know, to leave us alone and not to give us up, not to do anything to us, because he stopped coming. But this was finally that, you know, convinced my mother. My mother decided that we have no future here. We are going to die if we stay here. Where to go? We didn't have any money. We couldn't stay on the Aryan side. We didn't know people. We couldn't stay in the ghetto. We'll go back to Częstochowa. We have to go back to Częstochowa. And we knew that there is a ghetto in Częstochowa too, but at least there was some family, and it was a familiar place. So I left first. And it was all arranged by my mother, so I really don't know. And I regret that I did not ask my mother when she was still alive all these details that I would like to know now. But somehow, you know, I didn't think about it. Anyhow, what she arranged was that I was supposed to be at the ghetto gate. This was a gate on corner of Leszno and Żelazna. These were the streets. There was a barrier there, and the German gendarmes and the Jewish policemen, the Polish policemen. And I was to be there at 10, or around 10, and I was to have a book, and in the book there was money, And I was to approach the Jewish policeman and open the book, and then they would let me through. And I also knew that on the outside there is a young man, a Pole, who waits for me. She must have had some contacts. And this is what happened. My mother was standing far away, just watching. I mean, these places, the ghetto gates, were always surrounded by crowds of people. All types of things were happening there. Some exchanges, things for bread, you know, etc. A lot of killing, like little Jewish smugglers, who the beggars who would go out and smuggle some food, but when caught, they would be beaten or killed right there. Anyhow, my mother was standing there and watching me. I can imagine what she felt at that point. And I don't remember what I felt. I just don't remember. I went. I had...
Did she have any parting words for you?
Any parting
words, advice?
I don't remember. Of course, I knew that she will follow me, you know, and she can. And my book was the Iliad, Homer's Iliad. I loved this book. And I came, I opened the book. The Jewish policeman took the money, and I was out. And the German gendarmes were in the sentry box. So it was obviously, you know, they were making business together. Yeah, they
in
were
cahoots.
Dividing. So yeah. And this young man was waiting for me. This was terribly important because the ghetto gates and the stations, the train stations, were terribly dangerous. They were swarming with spies, with informers, with blackmailers, with just Germans, police, all types of people, and blackmail of Jews was very, unfortunately, common. So,
do you know the name of this Polish man?
No. He took me to the station. He took me in a tram. We were traveling in the tramway. It was all very, for 2 years I was behind the walls, and I did feel strange in this seemingly normal street, even though, you know, in the Polish streets things were going on too, constant roundups of young people. But it was different. So he took me to the station and he bought me a ticket. And this was also terribly important because you needed papers to buy a train ticket. And then he asked me if I'd be all right. And I said, yes, thank you very much. And he left. So I was left alone. I was dressed very stupidly, and this was a mistake that many Jews made. It was probably October, but it was a very warm October.
1941.
And I was in my winter coat because my mother decided that I shouldn't have lots of stuff, just a very small backpack. And the winter coat was heavy, so I should wear it. But this attracted attention, of course, you know, a winter coat. And I looked, I had a good look, so-called good look. I still had my braids. I was blonde at that time, and I didn't have any specific Semitic features.
Did you carry any identification with you?
No. I didn't have a false identification, so I didn't carry any. So Maybe 15 minutes. I still have had a couple of hours to wait for the train to come, and maybe 15 minutes after he left, I was surrounded by a group of Polish boys. They were 10 to 12 years old. And they started to tell me, oh, you are a kike, you know, you're a Jew. Give us something. If not, we are going to take you to... Somehow, I don't know, maybe because they were a little bit younger than I was, I collected myself and I started screaming at them. I told them, well, you such and such, you get away from me because I'm going to take you to the police. And I did get rid of them. It was, you know, it could have happened the other way around. But maybe because the way I looked and I sounded, my Polish, of course, was impeccable. And maybe they, because of that, they left me. Well, finally, the train arrived. And I boarded the train. At the beginning, there were not many people inside. And I was standing at the window and watching the fields. And I didn't see for a long time. But then people at the small stations, people started to come in, peasants, many women that looked very big, and it was obvious that they were smuggling food to the city under their clothes. Some of them had baskets. And after another while, I was so different from this crowd, with my coat, and standing at the window and not talking with anybody. And they started to talk to me. At the beginning, in a sort of a friendly way, sort of laughing, you know, and where do you go? Where are you from? Such a nice panienka. Panienka means mademoiselle. They would not say you to me. They would say panienka. But I blocked. I just stopped talking. And then they looked at me again and they told me, oh, you must be a little Jewish girl who is escaping from the ghetto. And then other people started to watch. And I saw there was somebody sitting there and reading and started to look. And I felt all the eyes on me. And then I felt that they were getting less friendly, and the word Jew was already pronounced, and I was terrified.
Nay, Richter, we left off, you were telling us about your train journey back to Częstochowa.
So as I said, the moment they said Jew, I felt trapped and I did not react anymore, and the atmosphere was getting less friendly. And at that moment, the train conductor came to check the tickets. He was a tall, older man. He probably was not older, but this is the way he looked to me at that time. He he sized up the situation quickly, and he asked for tickets in a very official way and asked what's going on here. And then one of these women said, oh, we had this little Jewish girl who is trying to escape the kikes from Warsaw. And this man looked at them and he told them in so many words that they have to mind their own business, and that he knows quite a few things about them too. You see, they were smugglers, so they were vulnerable, and they knew that there are policemen and Germans. Smuggling was punished. I cannot tell you how I felt about this man who really saved my life. I never saw him again, but I remember exactly how he looked. And I only spent one day outside of the ghetto during the war. Living outside of the ghetto was terrible. Hundreds of people I paid with their deaths for, you know, being Jewish. People were sold sometimes for a kilo of sugar or a bottle of vodka. However, everyone who did survive on the other side of the ghetto, including myself during this one day, survived because people helped him. So this has to be remembered.
There were good Poles too.
Yes. And in my case, completely unknown too, completely. Not friends, nobody who knew me. Just decent people. And so I came to Częstochowa. I went straight into the ghetto. I don't remember how I made my way, but I knew the place very well. And the ghetto, I went to live with my, to stay with one of my uncles. He was the one where my grandmother lived.
What was his name?
Manche. His name was Manche. He was younger than my father. He was a tailor. And there were three of them in the ghetto, in the Częstochowa ghetto. Two were very, very poor, very nice people, with families, everybody. This one was a little bit better off, and my grandmother lived with him. So this is where I was. I met my friends from school. It was much, much quieter and better than the Warsaw ghetto. The Warsaw ghetto was really terrible. The Częstochowa ghetto at that point, of course, you know, they were also rounding people, sending people out, killing, but there was no comparison. There was still some life going on, and the hunger certainly was not as terrible as that in Warsaw.
Was it a fenced ghetto in Częstochowa?
No, it wasn't fenced. It wasn't walled. It was fenced, but not walled.
And there were, who was in charge of the Częstochowa?
Well, there was Judenrat, yeah.
Would you know?
I know very little about them. No, I know very. There was Jewish police. The organization was the same. Yeah. But of course, the population was smaller. The hunger was not that bad.
And you knew people?
And I knew people, yes. I was not as isolated as I had been in the Warsaw ghetto.
Was the ghetto one large ghetto? Or what
this was a large ghetto. This was the first, the large ghetto. The liquidation of the ghetto did not come yet at that point. It came in 1942, both in Warsaw and here.
Did you work?
Well, no, at the beginning I didn't do anything special. I tried to join some of my friends to get some schooling, but they were advanced by 2 years, So I gave it up. And pretty soon, my brother came. My brother, as you know, was in Białystok with my father. He matriculated there. He enrolled in a medical school in Lvov. And he was supposed to start in 1941, but he didn't. Now, together with my father, they started to escape from Białystok, but they were late. My father was the editor of a newspaper. And he was an eternal optimist. He never believed there was going to be a war. It was the same in 1939, the same in 1941. He wanted to get his paper ready. So many of his friends managed to go, to run, and he, with my brother, were too late. They were overrun by the Germans, and they lost themselves. This was close to the city, to the town of Slonim. My brother didn't know what happened. And I never know how and exactly when my father died or was killed. Probably it happened in Slonim, where there were two massacres, large massacres, right at the beginning of the German rule. One. I beg your pardon?
Which was
the way? This was the. Starting, they came to Slonim a few days after the outbreak of the war in June 1941, and the Slonim massacres were one in July 41, the other one in November 41. But he may have been killed on the war, on the road. He may have, you know, there's no end to imagine how he died. How he was tormented, but I'll never know it. My brother started to walk back to Częstochowa. Somehow he maybe thought that we may be in Częstochowa rather than in Warsaw. He was then 18 or 17, and he walked all the way, and this is far away. This is from the northeastern part of the of Poland to the southwestern part of Poland. He avoided big cities and was walking through villages, stopping there to work, being fed. Of course, you know, he never disclosed his Jewish origin. And finally, he came to Częstochowa sometimes in October, or maybe it was November 1941. So the two of us were together, and pretty soon my mother joined us too. She also escaped the ghetto, and again, either I don't remember or I didn't ask her, I don't know the details of her escape.
Now, what was that feeling like, to be reunited with your brother?
Well, it was a good feeling, but unfortunately, I don't remember very much, or I never asked him any details of his life, my father, his life in the Russian part of Poland. I remember only a few Russian songs that he was singing. These were the first Russian songs I heard, and I liked them very much.
Would you like to sing one now?
No, I don't think I will. So my mother came. There were the three of us. Again, there was no money. We lived in the kitchen of my youngest uncle's apartment, and it was a room and a very small, narrow kitchen, and this is where we settled. This young man, we called him Romek, his Jewish name was Riven, was was a tailor also, and he had a wife with some type of a congenital heart disease, and at that time she was bedridden. She just couldn't walk. They had a little girl, a 4-year-old child. He gave us the kitchen, and we were there. My brother went to work. He started to work in so-called Mabel Lager, which was a large warehouse of furniture run by the Germans, and I understand that they were taking Jewish furniture, renewing them, collecting, repairing them, and sending them off to Germany. This was a very hard work. He was coming home very, very tired. I remember one scene. In this small kitchen, there was only a place for one bed, and then a cot that was put up only in the evening for him. And around 8 o'clock, after eating our soup, or maybe it was 7 o'clock in the evening, we all went to bed. And then a friend of Hennig came just to visit with his school friend. And he was from a rich family, a very nice boy. And he looked at this scene, and then he sat down on my brother's cot and asked him to whistle something for him, because Hennig whistled beautifully. And I remember this whistling. He whistled the Eine kleine Nachtmusik by Mozart. And we all cried. Well, we were poor. I started to do something, and I don't remember exactly what, but I remember cleaning some place where children played during the day. Was it sort of a communal kindergarten or something? So I would wash the floors there, but I don't remember very much of that. Well, this is how life was going on until September 1942. In September 1942, on the 22nd of September, the so-called big action started. But on the 21st of September, my brother came from work and told us to come with him. Apparently there was this German, his name was Lange, who was their supervisor. There were a group of young people, strong people working there. And he told them, tomorrow the ghetto will start being liquidated. The big action is started. And the Ukrainian and the Lettish troops are already in. And tonight they are going to surround the ghetto. And if you want, bring your closest family and they'll be hidden here. This is what I know. So we went.
What did you take with you?
Nothing. Literally nothing. We went as we stood, because he was rushing us, because it was close to the curfew. I don't even know how we went, because we had to go out of the ghetto. So it had to be somehow organized.
Did you not take any food with you?
Food? No. No, we didn't, but we were fed there. And so we went. We were put up in an attic. Actually, it wasn't an attic, really, because there were no stairs to go there. It was directly under the roof, a sort of a provisional bunker. And I don't know how many we were, about anything between 50 to 100, I don't know. Apparently there was another bunker in the cellar with families. We stayed there at least 2 weeks, if not more. I don't remember.
Was this some distance from the ghetto?
It was, but it was not very far.
What did you hear from your...
Well, what I heard was the selections that were being done over there. I mean, these boys lived there. Everybody who worked on this type of a German-run place was, I don't know the word in English, skoszarowani. They stayed there. And the rest of the people in the ghetto started to be, nice word for it is deported, but you know, I don't know what the word is.
The word you used, could that be labor brigade?
Could that be?
Polish word.
Yeah, could that be labeled? No.
Labor brigade, labor unit?
No.
No.
No, no. Koszarowani means that they lived there. Like the military live in barracks. Okay. So these boys and all the workers, all the Jewish workers, stayed there. We were in this attic and in the cellar being hidden. And the Germans, of course, would do their business, sending transport after transport of, 50 or so thousand Jews to Treblinka and killing many on the spot. But we didn't go through it. However, the Germans came to these places and they were making these selection it was called, over there. So what we heard was the screams of the Germans from the yard. And we never knew who was taken and who wasn't. But what was most important was that we had to be absolutely quiet, particularly during these selections on the courtyard. And there were some children there. So the children were... It was not always possible to keep them completely quiet. And I only remember that one child was suffocated by a pillow. Just his mouth was covered with a pillow. It was a young child who wouldn't stop crying. And after it all ended, the child was dead.
How were you? Who fed you while you were staying in the Möbel Lager?
Who stayed?
Who fed you?
The Möbel Lager. The same German and our boys. They would come in the evening through an opening in the masked opening in the ceiling. They would bring us food, and they would take our buckets down, I was better fed there than in the ghetto.
How long did you remain in hiding?
Well, it must have been more than 2 weeks, because the actions started on the 22nd of September 1942, and they ended around the 8th or so of October. So sometimes in the middle of October, when the small ghetto was already organized, we were smuggled into this small ghetto. And we were not the only one, because there were people in bunkers, prepared bunkers, all types of people, so they came back.
How many people do you estimate were in the large ghetto before the deportations began, approximately?
Yeah. Well, I told you before that there were 30,000 Jews approximately in Warsaw.
In addition,
there were people from the neighboring little towns. And I believe that the total number was close to 45,000-50,000. What was left in the small ghetto was 5,000 people. Everybody else went. Out of my three uncles with their families, only one, Manche, the first one that I stayed with, was still alive. His family, of course, my grandmother and his wife and the child, and the other two families, entire families, were perished there. They were transported to Treblinka, and many of them killed on the spot. I can imagine that my grandmother, who was
the elderly, the young,
and this young woman with heart disease who couldn't get out of bed, you know, for sure. But again, I'll never know.
I wanted to ask you, what would be the reason for them keeping a labor force behind in a small ghetto, if you could tell us about it?
They went after their business in a very systematic way. They wanted to exterminate, and the final solution was a final solution, all the Jews. But as long as some Jews were useful, working, doing something, you know, they kept them.
And where were the remaining Jews employed?
Well, there were all types of places. There was the place that later on became my camp, my concentration camp, and it was an munition factory, large munition factory. Then there was a steel mill, Rakov, and there were places like this Mabel Lager and some other places.
The factory at Rakov and the one that you were employed in later on, did they belong to an organization as such?
Yes. Before the war, this ammunition factory used to be a textile, actually, place owned by French people. And then when the Germans came, they rebuilt the whole place. They needed a munition factory. They brought all the machines and equipment. And there were some other places. In Częstochowa was a fairly industrial place, so this is where these people worked. So 5,000 or so of us were left in the small ghetto. The small ghetto was a horror. The small ghetto, we were like hunted animals. You went to work in the morning. They would take us in groups to different places, and we would come back in the evening. And you never know who is going to come back or who is going to be left, who you are going to find there. But now I want to talk about my brother. Very soon after the organization of this small ghetto, my brother came to my mother and myself, and he told us that he's joining a partisan group. There were six of them, six young boys I knew, and they already had some guns. Later on I learned that there was a unit of the Job, the Jewish fighting organization in Częstochowa, and this was most probably part of it. So he went. This must have been around November or December of 1942. They went. Well, I don't know. Should I finish his story, or should I go in a chronological way?
I think let's talk about your brother.
Yeah. We didn't hear from him for a long time, but then in March, and this was around the 17th of March of 1943, my mother got a message. The message said that they are in the city now, they came to the city, and he wants to talk with her and to see her, and he is going to be in a bunker together with these other boys in Mabel Lager. And when she goes to work, her group was passing by there. It was arranged with a couple that on the way back from work, she would join her son in the bunker and spend the night with them, and then in the morning she would be picked up by her group again to go to work. So nobody would notice that she's not at work. At that time, we had an idea, or at least this is what it seems to me, that the boys had some problems joining a group of partisans. There was the Polish underground was divided. There was the mainstream, the home army, Armia Krajowa. There was the left, the Armia Ludowa, the Folks Army. And there were some very right-wing group, some of them extremely virulent and very, very anti-Semitic, who actually fought with the Germans and with the Jews. And the idea was that they may have some problems finding the AL, which is the false army that did accept Jews. But I didn't know, and I still don't know exactly what happened. So the next thing I knew, on the 18th of March, I came back from work. This was the night when my mother was supposed to join my brother.
Five, with Hanna Strawczynski, née Richter. You were telling us about the meeting that your mother had with your brother Henrik.
Yes.
March 18th, 1943.
Right. This was March 18th, 1943, and I knew that my mother is going to stay during the night with my brother in the bunker. I came back from work. It was a very unpleasant March. It was raining and snowing. It was dark already. I came back from work. It was completely dark. And I was going towards my, where we lived. And I had to cross a yard to get into this room that we shared with some other people, a small ghetto was just a few streets, very miserable, the poorest in the city. I remember the mud, I remember the darkness, and I, as I was approaching the door, I heard this terrible scream of my mother. This, I'll never get rid of this picture and the feeling of sinking feeling, not only inside me, but I felt that everything is finished. I knew that it must have something to do with my brother. So what I learned was that as my mother was coming back from work, ready to join the boys, they were let out by Germans. They were found. And she saw him. Being led to his death. You know, I was young in the ghetto, and I think I was lucky. I can't imagine what it was like to be a mother in the ghetto. Anyhow, so this is what happened. They were killed at the Jewish cemetery the next day in the morning. I don't know what was happening to them during that night. They spent the night in jail, apparently, where they tortured by the Gestapo. I don't know. Of course, they had arms with them. They had pistols, grenades. Did they have to dig their own grave? I don't know. And I'll never know. Somehow I never stopped mourning my brother. I don't know why. I feel differently with the death of my father and the death of my mother. But this young life, he was 19. He was going to be 20 in 1 month.
What was the effect on your mother?
Well, my mother was insane. The first few hours, I had problems calming her down. I kept telling her, no. It was not him. It was not him. Maybe it was not him. She gradually calmed down. She had to live for me. And we never talked about it anymore. And this is another thing that I regret, because she must have known more about how they were actually discovered. There are two versions. One is that at least a little Jewish boy who was hidden actually in the bunker somewhere around there went out, and he was spotted by SS men coming by, and they started to pick him up and tell us who's here and where are you and where is your mother and is there anybody else around here, and he gave them up. This is one version. Another version that I read in some books, but it's all hearsay. Nobody knows exactly. Another version was that perhaps they did join, apparently they did join some group, but this group of partisans didn't quite trust them, And they told them, well, all right, you are going, some action was being prepared for them in the city, you'll go there, but you have to give us the address where you'll be. And there is this version that this is how they were given up. But I don't know where the truth is. It just shows you the possibilities. Everything was possible in Poland during the war. So my brother was executed on the 19th of March.
I wanted to ask you where you worked in the small ghetto.
I don't remember exactly, but very soon I started to work in the Hazard that later on became the labor camp. And so did my mother. So before that happened, before this march, of course, you know, there were other things happening in the small ghetto. As I said, the small ghetto was just a killing ground, just you know, terrible, constant selections. And on January the 4th, I remember this one very well. This was, my brother was already away, but still alive. They didn't take anybody to work. They told us to stay in the ghetto, so we knew that things are going to happen. And they told us to everybody to come to this so-called Stary Rynek, which is the old marketplace, a small place. My mother said, we are not going. She tried it. From there on, we tried to hide as much as possible. So everybody went. We went up to the attic. It was a fairly plain attic. Some other people were there too, just counting on their luck that nobody may be welcome. And I believe that there was a tiny window there from which I could see what's going on in the marketplace. But when I think about it, it may just as well be what I heard from other people again and again. And I have the picture, and I don't know. I don't remember if I really saw it, or was it from all these tales about what was happening. So what I think I saw was this crowd of people in complete silence standing there. The small market, it was a little miserable square, and the house where we were hiding was bordering this square. And all we heard there, and this we heard, was screaming of the Germans, some orders being given. And what I saw, or I think I saw, was a group of Germans, maybe 10 of them, including Degenhardt. This was the ruler of the Transdorf ghetto. He's the man who was in charge of liquidating the Jews.
Was he a German?
Yes, oh yes, he was a German SS man, yeah. And the Judenrat people were standing there, and they were making a selectia, pulling out people that they didn't need anymore. The crowd was getting bigger and bigger. Now, Mr. Freiman, our neighbor, was pulled out. He was very well known in the ghetto. He was a wonderful man. He was cooking kettles of soup every Saturday to feed the poor. So they knew him. And somebody from the Judenrat, when he was pulled out as an older man, reclaimed him. And then he was pulled out again, and again he was reclaimed. And then what happened was that two young men threw themselves on the Germans with pistols. One of them was Ijo Feiner, who was a friend of my brother from school, and the other one was Mendel Fischlevich. And they had pistols, and apparently these pistols jammed. So they were killed on the spot.
Resisting the German acts.
Yes. And after that, they took every tent from this crowd to be finished off, killed. And Mr. Freiman was also the tent. So twice he escaped, and this time he was taken. These people were killed almost immediately, some of them right on the spot there, and others at the at the cemetery. There were a few hundred people that died on that day. The Freiman family was still alive. His wife, his two children, his son who was married and had a baby. They hid themselves. They were in hiding during the big action. So the wife, the following day, his wife took the baby and went to the train with the baby. The two children survived. Okay.
We did mention a little while back, and I'd like to get back to that, is when you left the ghetto and you moved into the camp and working for Hazak.
Yeah.
How did that come
about? I'm coming to that, yeah. So I've been coming to that. So I told you about the march, the killing of my brother, and pretty soon, in June 1943, the ghetto was liquidated. And a lot of people again selected out, but we did not go through the selection on that day. No, we were working in the Hazak, so we were kept there.
I wanted to ask you, sorry, before we talk about Hazak, did you know where these deportations were going to at that stage?
Yeah, at that stage. At that stage we knew a lot. Yeah.
Where were they going?
They were going to Treblinka, and we also knew that they were being shot at the Jewish cemetery. Most of them were going to Treblinka. Well, so we found ourselves in the Hazak. So there was only 2,000 or 3,000 of us left, the workers that were necessary to run the German war industry. But that same night, there was a selection in the Hazak, too. Apparently, too many people made their way there. And this we could not escape. I don't know if it was that same night or a few nights later. It was at night. It was at 10 o'clock in the evening. And they told us to march, six of us in a row. The place was illuminated. It was 10 o'clock in the evening, but it was bright, bright light. And this time in this selection, there were the Werkschutz, the people that were guarding us in the camp, who took part in it, and the foreman, the German foreman, the civilian workers who worked for this place. And as we were marching through, of course my mother, after the death of her son, was ruined. And there were three people, she was the fourth, I was the fifth, I believe. And I don't know, it was a moment, just one moment. My mother was pulled out by a civilian foreman. She was pulled out. And I ran after her. I don't know. I didn't think at that point. It was just, I just ran after my mother. We were collected on the side, and the group was getting bigger and bigger. Older people, some children. My mother despairing that I was there, and why did I come? We were put in some little, I believe it was a little factory hall, until the entire group was collected, the selection was finished, and then we were led out. And as we stood there, I thought it was close to a wall, and I was sure that they are going to shoot us there. Somehow I, you know, all the Werkschutz people were there with their machine guns, and I thought, that's it. It's strange, because I remember having some amazing clarity of mind. I don't remember any great fear. I saw my short life somehow, and I thought about my name that I left on my school desk. You know, like children do this Richard. Type of thing. Yeah. Yes. And I think I thought, well, this is what's going to be left. And then my mother pulled me, and she started talking to the Werkschutzleiter, who was a sadist. His name, I believe, was Clem. And she was telling him, let her go, she was not pulled out, she is, you know. And when I heard it, I said, no, I didn't know any German, so I just said, wir beide, wir beide. Only the two of us. And he let us go. And he told us to go. And I didn't believe him for a moment. My mother started to pull me and to run. And I told her, no, I don't want. He'll shoot us from the back. I don't want it. But then nobody was shooting, and we went. And we came to this. The barracks were not built yet, because it was the very beginning of the camp. And we were sleeping on some bunks in a factory hall. And I remember coming there, and lots of people crying, sitting there and crying. And we approached our bunk, and there were some people who knew us, and there was a young woman who was sitting on the top bunk and crying. Because we were not there. And when she saw us, she fell off the bank. And we started to laugh. So the next day was like a dream. I was not quite, I don't remember. I was working in the camp on a machine. It was calibrating the cartridges. It was not hard work. But we were, of course, guarded constantly and harassed and beaten up occasionally. I only remember this day following this incident during our breaks, the soup break, people would come to look at me. And my mother, such a wonder, a child went after her mother. When many mothers were and survived. And how did, what happened to this man? Why did he was a sadist. He, killing for him was nothing. I don't know. I'll never know. Well, anyhow, so we survived and we worked there. There were some Poles working there. It was interesting because there were some, I remember close to my machine, there was a long table with four or five young, good-looking Polish girls. Maybe they were German Volksdeutsche, you know what it is. Yes. But they were Poles to me. And at the beginning, they looked at us, and I could see that they looked at us with some horror and some pity. And as the time went on, they started to look through us. They didn't see us anymore. They got used. There was a young Polish foreman who was a specialist of this particular machine that I worked on. And in the beginning, he was friendly. He was good.
Do you remember his name?
Tadek. But then he got completely depraved. He was depraved by another Polish. She was a Volksdeutsche, Irena, who was sleeping around with Germans and with him too. And then he was just like everybody else.
Did your contact with these non-Jewish Poles give you access to information about the war and what was transpiring?
Well, yes, there was a little bit of that. Yes, there was a little bit of that. So we knew that the Russians are approaching. We knew. But how to survive? Now, in the meantime, we spent 2 years, still 2 years to go in the camp. We worked, we starved, we... many of us, of course, were pulled out and killed and murdered and sent out in transport. How to survive was the question. Well, at the end, we started to hear the Russian artillery, the Russian Katyusha, the last few days. This was already January 1945, and we started to hear the Katyushas, and 2 weeks before it all ended, my mother and I lost our jobs, which meant we were in a group of people that was being collected to be sent. Now, these lists were made by Jewish capos.
Do you know the names of any of the couples?
No. Well, even if I know, I'm not talking about it. She was a young woman. She was from the same school that we were. She was 1 year older than my brother. She was not bad, actually. She was asked to make a list, and she had to make a list. So she picked up a person who was older and a person who was younger, who sort of did not fit and may die anyway. I don't know. Anyhow, at that point, we were waiting for a transport. We were just living for a few more days, maybe. And we lost our food rations, so we were starved. And we did something, I believe, cleaning potatoes. They were frozen potatoes. They put us there, so we ate the raw skin, potato skins, you know. But then the 16th came, the 16th of January, and on the 16th of January, it was clear that the Russians are very, very close. We heard them, and the Germans started to panic. The wagons were there, just behind the camp. There was a train being prepared for us. The Germans took a lot of men with them. They ended up in Buchenwald, in all types of places, and in the death march, and not many of them came back. But we hid again with my mother. In the last panic, in the last collection of people, you know, to be thrown into the wagons. Oh, yeah. I don't even remember where we were hiding, just, you know, in little corners, just behind machines, behind big soup kettles, I remember, in the kitchen. We were hiding. And as the 16th, as the evening came, it was quiet. It became to be very quiet. Then around midnight, it was completely quiet and there was nobody in this place except the two of us. And my mother said, come, we'll see what's happening. We started to go and there was nobody and there were no Germans. And we started to walk and we came out of the factory grounds where the Germans lived. And there was nobody, and we just walked like lunatics. We just walked in the night. This was already early morning, 17th, and we walked through the camp gate, and we were out. And we started to walk. We were in rags. Well, I didn't tell you, of course, how we were freezing there, how we were kept, you know, after 12 hours of work, standing in the snow for... My legs were frostbitten. We were in wooden clogs. We had numbers here and all types of things. But we started to walk. This was a very, very cold January 17th.
Midwinter.
Yeah. And there were thousands of people walking from all over, again, people returning, people going. Nobody paid any attention to us, but what is the strangest is that the Wehrmacht, the German army, was walking out of the city. They were in complete silence, walking out of the city on the road. I only heard the sound of the snow under their boots. And all of us were on the sidewalks, walking. Not a word, not a shot, nothing. They marched out of the city that very day. So this was the 17th of January. And we were liberated by the Russians.
What did that feel like?
Well, we went, the first steps was into a home. My mother knew some people there, so we went in. And they, of course, took us in. They gave us some food. I didn't know. I was like in a dream. And then in the morning, in the early morning, I saw these first Soviet tanks.
Ski ne Richter. We left off talking about liberation.
Yes. So I told you that we were in a place of, in an apartment of two Polish ladies that knew my mother from before the war. And it was early morning, the 17th of January, and I saw my first Russian tanks. And a soldier jumped off and ran and knocked on the door. It was a very close, the closest apartment to the street. He was a short Asian soldier, a Kalmyk or Uzbek or whatever, I don't know. He was short, he had typical oriental face. He came because he was thirsty. and he was in a terrible hurry. He wanted water. So they gave him water, and he drank, and he ran back after his tank. But this site is one of the few that will be etched in my mind always. For me, this was liberation, this was freedom, it was all in this little Russian soldier, Soviet soldiers, not even Russian, who was standing there and drinking water. I was very, very moved by that. Well, so the war ended, and a few survivors started to come back. We stayed with my mother. I went to school. A Jewish committee was formed. We got all types of help. And life was sort of picked up, you know, from there on.
Was it possible to make a new life?
Well, obviously it was. How it was possible, I don't know. But obviously life is stronger than anything else, and you make new life. We lived in a place, in a room, also together with a few other young women. My mother was the only one that was older, and in a way it was very, very important for us, because the Russians liked young girls, and they were trying to talk them into sleeping with them. They were not raping us, no. The rapes, of course, we know about them in Germany and other places. But here they were hungry for love, for women, for everything. They had a terrible, terrible war. You know how many of them were killed, died. Anyhow, my mother was the one who protected us, and they listened to her. They would bring us food. They would bring us drinks sometimes, you know. They would drink, and we would just sit there, listen to their songs.
What I wanted to ask you is, what was the response of the non-Jewish Czechoslovakian Polish to the survivor, the Jewish survivors,
yes,
of the camps?
Well, the war was not really finished for the Poles yet. The Russians came in. They were not welcomed at all for them. They liberated them from the wars, but this meant a new occupation. They knew what it meant. They identified the Jews very strongly with communism. And of course, there was a lot of deprived people during the war, people who were wild, people who were used to death, to killing, to anything. So there were many, many anti-Semitic excesses after the war during that time, at the very beginning. However, I went to school, and at school I had some friends. I had two Polish girls, very, very nice, who befriended me. Anyhow, to make the whole story a little bit shorter, my mother got sick. She was sick already, of course, you know, after the camp and after the war. And she got sicker and sicker, and it turned out that she had a cancer that was already spread and neglected, of course, uterine cancer, and she died in April of 1946. April 18, 1946. So I was left alone. I must have been pretty callous myself at that point. And, you know, I told you, people were so used to what was going on. Everybody lost everybody else. So I was alone too. I remember this little scene when I was interviewed for, I applied for a bursary to go to the university, and I was called, and this man, probably one of the teachers or clerks in the ministry, I don't remember, was talking to me and asking, and then as I was telling him that, well, I was in the ghetto, and I was here, and I was there, and now my mother died not so long ago, a few months ago, he looked at me with horror and real pity, and he said, "My God, you know, you're so young." And I looked at him, and I shrugged my shoulders. I said, "Well, you know, I'm like everybody else around me." He was amazed. He couldn't understand it. But this is how I was, I think. I stayed in Częstochowa until I matriculated. I did 2 years. In 2 years, I did the entire material of high school. There were many schools for adults. A lot of Poles didn't have any possibility to educate themselves either. Then after that, I went to university in Lodz Medical School.
What was the motivating factor to
go into
medical?
I don't know. I thought about it. Maybe there were none. Maybe I just thought it would be a good idea to be a doctor. But I always wanted to be a pediatrician. And I never forgot the Jewish ghetto, the Warsaw ghetto, the little Jewish beggars. And maybe this influenced me. My brother also enrolled in a medical school, so I don't know why. However, in Lodz, I lived in so-called Bursa. This was a home for Jewish young people returning from all over, from camps, from Russia. It was supported by the Jewish committee, by the American Jews, basically. And this was a good time. This was the time when we found a family. Everybody was alone, everybody. And we had a good time together, and we never talked about what happened. We didn't know each other's, camps or ghettos or whatever. This was somewhere there that either we wanted to forget or we were too busy. Most of these people were studying. Many worked, and I spent only 1 year there, but I met Oscar there, my husband.
Could you give us his full name?
Oscar Strawczynski, born in 1918. He's an engineer. We met in this Lodz Bursa. I stayed there from 1947 to 1948. In 1948, Oscar went to Palestine, or Israel, newly formed Israel, to fight there in this new country. But he came back after a year, after the war was over, and he fought with the Haganah, and he came back, and then we got married. We moved to Warsaw. So I transferred to the Warsaw Medical School, and this is where we lived. We decided to live in Poland. We supported the new government and the new system. We did believe, like my parents did, that this is what is going to bring freedom and no exploitation and a wonderful world forever. Well, we were naive, however. We lived there. My daughter was born in 1953.
And what is her name?
Her name is Eva. She works, she was five when we came to Canada.
So what was the motivating factor to come to Canada?
Yeah. Well, I think that the motivating factor was a growing disenchantment with and knowledge what is really behind this system, disenchantment, and the fact that we had a child and the memories of the war started to come and to be more and more vivid. My husband survived in Russia, but his memory, he lost the entire family also. He came back and didn't find anybody. So we started to think about how safe would it be to be here. It's not a safe country, not only for Jews. It's just not a safe country, period, you know, with a terrible history. And my husband had a family in Canada, also from Poland, but they left immediately after the war. Two of them survived Treblinka. So in 1959, with our five-year-old daughter, and I have been a doctor since 1952, a pediatrician in Poland, we left and we came to Montreal.
And were there any additions to the family once you arrived in Canada?
For a long time, there were none. I waited 15 years between one child and the other. And it took me time for me to get used to Canada, to get into internship and residency, to repeat my almost entire training, to pass all the exams. It took 5 years altogether. And then in 1968, my son was born. His name is David. And I've been working right from the beginning. After I finished all my exams, I became a pediatrician and then a pediatric rheumatologist at the Montreal Children's Hospital, a member of the faculty, an associate professor of pediatrics. And this is where we are. Of course, coming to Canada was a shock. It was such a displacement, not only coming from one country or one continent to another, but linguistic and cultural displacement. And it was a shock to meet the Canadian Jews who didn't know much about what was going on. They were very different. They looked at us either indifferently or with some suspicion. How come you survived this type of thing? However, well, they just didn't know. Maybe it's good that they didn't know. You need some completely abnormal imagination to know.
It's a very good point.
Yeah. So this is my story.
I wanted to ask, first of all, thank you very much for your most comprehensive and detailed testimony and the emotional input that you've put into the testimony, and one or two concluding questions, if you will. What do you think the main effects of your experiences have been upon you as a person, as a parent? Could you tell that?
Well, yes, certainly I've been thinking about it more and more as I get older, and I realize more and more as I get older to what extent all this affected me. It was inescapable. Constant chronic anxiety, always expecting a loss. There are so many losses. Always expecting the worst thing to happen. This is something that my children, of course, felt very strongly, and it affected them, I know. Constant anxiety over their safety. Every little illness, every little delay in coming home was something happened. The scenarios that I am still making constantly for my children and my entire family is incredible. This is how it is. So in a way, yeah, I was very deeply affected.
But and your communist beliefs, were they affected?
Oh, well, look, this was long ago. This was long ago, yeah. I've learned something since. Mm. Yeah, and this is something that I learned, and I think I wish all young people learn not to believe in, not to follow, to question.
That would be your message to the next generation?
This would be my message, yeah, well, if I have any message. However, you know, having said all this about how the war affected me, I must say that I never felt like a victim. I never really thought about myself as a victim. And I hate when I resent when people talk to me as if I were a victim. I spoke very little about what I went through. I hate the exploitation of the Holocaust. And I only talk about it when I'm really asked with interest.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. To the right of me stands my daughter Eva. She's my firstborn, born in 1953. Next to her is my husband, Oscar, born in 1918, still working part-time. Then there is David. David was born in 1968. And he is now looking for a job since he's finishing his master's degree, just finishing schools. And next to him is her dear friend and our dear friend, Rosemary. Rosemary's name is Rosemary Barrett. She's from Montreal. They've been together for 3 or almost 4 years, and she's now finishing her degree in social work. This is an old picture. It shows a group of friends. My father standing to the right.
His full name?
My father, David, and my mother, Felicia, or Fela, sitting in the middle in the white blouse. This was made in Częstochowa. Probably shortly after they met, around the year of 1919 maybe, or 1920.
And their last name?
Fela Klin and David Richter. Częstochowa, 1922 or around, standing from the back. At the left is my father. Next to him is my mother.
Their names?
Fela, my father David, my mother Fela, my uncle Isaac, my other uncle Morris, my third uncle Hirsch, my grandfather sitting Leib, the youngest brother in the family Reuven, and my grandmother Estera. And in front of my father, there is Manche, the one who survived the war.
And the family name?
His father. The family name was Richter.
Excellent.
This is my mother, Fela Richter, with her firstborn, Henik Richter, made in Częstochowa in 1923 or beginning 1924. This is Częstochowa, my mother with her two children. On the left is myself at the age of 3.
Your name?
My name, Hanka, Hanka Richter. On the other side of my mother is Henik Richter, my brother, who was then 7 seven and a half.
And your mother's name?
Fela. My mother's name was Fela Felicia. This is a family Richter in Częstochowa in 1930. Starting from the right is the youngest brother of my father, Reuven or Romek or Reuven Richter. Next to him is my mother, Fela. Standing behind her is my brother, Henek. I don't know the lady sitting at the table. Next to her is my grandmother, Estera. Then sitting is the wife of my uncle, Isaac, and her name was Hanna Lea. Behind her is her child, I don't know the name. And in the middle standing is Manche, one of the uncles, Manche Richter. This is my father, David Richter, from Częstochowa. The picture was taken in Warsaw in 1934.
The family, we're going to go on.
To the left, there is a picture of my mother, Fela Richter, with myself, Hanka Richter, in Częstochowa in 1935. On the right side, it is myself, Hanka Richter, with my brother Henja Richter. This was taken in the country during summer vacation, and the year was 1936. And this is the picture of a school orchestra marching through the town of Częstochowa. My brother is playing the trumpet, my brother Henek. He's third from the right.
What school was this?
The name of the school was the Jewish Gymnasium. This is the picture of my family in Warsaw in 1938 during summer vacation. On the left is my brother Henek. Next is my mother Fela, my father David, and myself, Hanka Richter. This picture was found in the mud after the war, and it is damaged. This is a picture taken in Warsaw in 1939. It's the last picture of my father. On the left is my brother in a uniform that they had to wear for the class of military training. And on the right, it is myself. And this is the last one from before the war.
And your name?
Yes, I said the name. Henek Richter, David Richter, and Hanka Richter. This is the last picture of my brother Henek. This was made in Częstochowa in 1941. He's 17 here, and he just came back walking from Białystok to Częstochowa.
Last name?
Henek Richter. My brother Henek was a partisan. Henek Richter, he was killed in March 19, 1943, and he was posthumously decorated with this order in 1948. By the Polish government. This picture was taken in Częstochowa immediately after the war, and it shows the ruins of the ghetto in Częstochowa and the survivors walking through the ruins. Okay. This is a picture taken 2 months after the liberation. It's my mother is on the left, Fela Richter. I'm on the right, Hanka Richter, and this is following the disinterment of the bodies of my brother and his partisan friends. There are 6 names there, and the text says, "Glory to the to the young heroes, something of this sort. This is a picture taken in Warsaw in 1949 after my husband, Oskar Strawczynski, who is on the right, returned from fighting in Haganah in Israel. I am in the middle, I am Hanka Richter, and to the left is a friend. This is a picture from Poland. We were on vacation in the Polish mountains Tatry. To the right is my daughter, Eva Strawczynski, then my husband, Oskar Strawczynski, and Hanka Strawczynski, myself. These are our children. This is in Canada. To the left, there is Eva Strawczynski, aged 15 here, or 16, and David Strawczynski, 1 year old. This is a picture of our family in our home, in the garden of our home in 1982. To the left is my daughter Eva, then my husband Oscar, my son David, and myself, Hanna Strawczynski.
Taken in Montreal.
Here in Montreal, in our garden. This is 1982 in Montreal. It's the graduation from college of my daughter Eva. From the left is my son David, my husband Oscar, then Eva with her diploma, and myself, Hanna Strawczynski.
I saw you clicking it.
This is 1985. It's the matriculation of my son David Strawczynski, who is in the middle. My husband Oscar is on the left, and I am on the right. And it's an important picture for me because I'm wearing a wig here, just recovering from 1 year of very, very serious illness, which I also survived. This is a wall hanging made by my father back in 1938. He did this type of things for money, to earn a little bit more money. And it represents a picture by a famous Polish painter, Strijeńska, called the Polish Autumn, the Golden Polish Autumn. It's made from felt.
And your father's full name?
My father who did it was David Richter, I'm sorry.